everyone. My guest today is John Gray, who's President and Chief Operating Officer of Blackstone. And John, I'm thrilled to have you with us here today to get your investment outlook in what is clearly an unprecedented global market. So really appreciate you being here.
Great to be here, Allison. Thanks for having me.
So if you could take me back to the beginning of 2020, what were you thinking about in terms of opportunities in January, February, March, you know, Asia in January, the United States, March? What were your thoughts back then?
I would say at the beginning of the year, there wasn't a huge amount of focus. There wasn't a lot of dislocation in markets. All of that, of course, changed in March. And what happened then was you tried to say, where is there opportunity? You've been through other crises and shocks before. Where can we deploy capital? And generally, it's not in private markets because people don't sell their companies or their real estate. The opportunities exist on the screen in liquid securities. And so we then look at where do we have a lot of domain expertise? Where do we know something because the market's moving quickly, but we still have confidence? And fortunately, areas like real estate, public REITs traded off a lot, MLPs, midstream assets that we know from the energy space, leveraged loans, all of these assets traded off 25 to 65%. And we said, this feels like it's overdone. We ended up deploying about $11 billion during that period, really in March through the very beginning of April. And then it's as if you closed your eyes too fast and it went away. And what was surprising, I think, to all of us was the speed at which central banks moved and the speed at which the federal government moved. And all of that put a floor under markets. And so the opportunity, the liquid opportunity, was more constrained in time than we would have expected. And we did very well with those investments. And our regret is we should have done more.
So where are you focused now? And, you know, what do you think are the long-term implications for investing?
So we love to think about investing thematically and what are the big picture things driving opportunity? Where will values go up? And I would say today it falls into two main areas. The first is where there are trends that have been interrupted by the pandemic. So think about global travel, which has grown at 5+% for 50 years. Obviously, not many people are traveling, but when there's a perception of safety, this will recover. So that could be airports, it could be hotels, it could be meetings businesses. Think about location-based entertainment, going to Disney World, going to a water park, going to a rock concert. People are gonna wanna do that again. And then I would add urbanization. So the idea today is no one wants to be in cities, they're nervous, kids aren't moving to cities. We believe fundamentally they will return over time and that will create opportunities. And so that would be one whole area where the pandemic has interrupted themes that should recover, but you have to price in a difficult period over the next year or two. The second big area would be where the pandemic has accelerated trends. And most of this is in the virtual world. So you would think about things like e-commerce, because basically we've seen a step function increase in demand for goods coming online. I would say content creation is another area worth focusing on, which is watching movies, TV shows, playing video games, music. All of this content we're watching on our devices needs to get made. And so there are businesses that service content creation. There are advertising businesses tied to that. And then there are physical assets. We just bought a bunch of studios in Hollywood based on this. I would say digital infrastructure, wireless towers, data centers, fiber, again, supporting this movement online and the migration to the cloud. And I would add life sciences, which has certainly gotten an additional boost.
So John, Blackstone's very global. What about geographies?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. What's fascinating about most of these trends is that they're remarkably similar. So many of these trends are global in nature. Now, there are differences. I would say overall, I would be biased geographically again towards countries that are more exposed to technology and growth. That's beneficial, I think, for China and certainly the United States. So I think the most important thing today is probably a little less the specific geography and more some of these big themes. Overall, I think the big economies will recover, and in the near term, Asia is going to be stronger.
Okay, now I want to talk about creating the right investment culture, because you've obviously been very successful at that at Blackstone. And can you tell me what you think some of the keys to your success as an investor have been?
In terms of specifically when I think about for myself, I would say being high conviction in my approach to investing is probably the most important thing. That identifying a theme, a business, or something I really believe in, going all in, that has paid off. And that when I just sort of dabble things around, it tends not to work out as well. So if you went back to the financial crisis before, we bought Hilton Worldwide in 07, a terrible timed investment. We had to put in a bunch of money at the bottom of the crisis. People thought that was crazy, but we believed in the management team. We believed in the business. We believed in hotel demand over time and the strength of the brands. And ultimately, we made $14 billion, and we had a lot of conviction at a challenging time. And the biggest theme we've pushed on has been global logistics, which started after that last crisis, basically because you could buy warehouses inexpensively. And we stumbled on the fact that e-commerce tenants were showing up in huge scale, and that got us enthused. And today, we own nearly $100 billion of warehouses. And so, for me, this idea of really finding something you believe in is important.
And with your next gen investing professionals, how do you teach them?
You want people who are passionate, who love this, who view it like a sport, that they want to compete, they want to deliver for the investors, they're passionate about figuring it out, they're willing to do the homework and legwork, and then they come up with their own view, which I think is really important. And I don't know if you can train that. They have a drive to do something and to learn, and they sort of decide to really go after it. The hard part to train is that last part, that sort of trigger pulling, which is after you've done all the work and you've decided, you know, we should invest in this geography, even though everyone's saying no, or this industry, you still go for it.
What would you say is the biggest challenge Blackstone faces today?
One is obviously the cultural challenge when you have the folks spread out. I'd say the second challenge is how do you invest capital in an environment where the economic climate is very challenging and yet valuations are pretty strong? And that is a reflection, obviously, of very accommodative policy, low rates. You're discounting future cash flows at very low rates. And so the disconnect between an economy that's challenged and valuations that are that high, how you navigate that is probably the biggest challenge we face.
So speaking of valuations, what will the S&P 500 be a year from now, higher or lower than it is today?
Well, we're not stock pickers, but what would I say? I would say multiples are high, but I think a year from now we'll have a vaccine which will allow large portions of the economy to restart and recover. And I think Fed policy and central bank policy around the world will continue to be quite accommodative. So I would say slightly higher valuations.
So now I want to ask about China-US. Will the China-US relationship be closer or further apart 1 year from now?
I would say hopefully closer, but my base case is it'll probably still be fairly tense. I don't see sort of an easy solution in the near term.
All right, so finally, what advice would you have for someone starting out in investing today that you wish someone had told you when you were first starting your career?
So I guess I would tell people to take a risk, to move to a different country, go to that new startup division. For me, it was just serendipity. I came to Blackstone in the private equity and M&A area, and they started a real estate business about a year into it. And a couple of folks recommend, do you want to do it? And I said, yes. So taking that risk, being able to learn, that was hugely important.
So thank you so much for joining me. Really appreciate your insights, and stay safe and stay healthy.
Thank you, Allison. It was great.